I think that what we saw in Paris is truly a very clear example of a transformation of the world that is already has already started. Like the Secretary General of the United Nations, Guterres, Antonio Guterres said, the train has left the station, so anybody that doesn't get on the train will be left behind. So it was really very interesting, high quality of dialogues, mm-hmm. very powerful and very impressive points made by the leaders of industry and of the countries. It was really a very successful meeting. We have resources, we have solutions. I would say that we have the political will. We are seeing today, only 2 years after the Paris Agreement was signed, 170 countries have ratified. Mm-hmm. That's a record for a multilateral treaty of this nature. I also see, encouraged and am optimistic when I see the personal commitment and the enthusiasm that we really get from so many of the actors, because this agenda, the climate change agenda, is an agenda that requires the full participation in each and every sector of society. And this is why, for me, it is very important also to engage in dialogue with absolutely all the actors in the economy, all the actors in our societies, at the international level. We cannot afford to not get the conversation going with any one of them. Mm-hmm. What we need to achieve now in Poland will be a good package that allows the Paris Agreement to become fully operational, but at the same time that reflects this more wider framework. Yeah. I speak of Poland and the results that we need to deliver as Paris 2.0. It's like Paris was the birth of the Paris Agreement. So we have a framework. Now Poland will be really the pieces and the directives and guidelines in order to make that framework really operate. On agriculture, I have to say that right now at COP23, we got a very important resolution that will now, for the first time in many, many years, allow us to start a very serious and detailed conversation on agriculture. And it has to do with the fact that over 90% of the NDCs, the national climate change plans, have a content on agriculture. So it's very challenging, but it's the framework that was agreed is, okay, let's look at agriculture, but let's look at it in the framework also of the SDG regarding zero hunger. So it's not about really reducing emissions by producing less food, by making people hungry. It's let's find solutions in order to address emissions, but at the same time also a very important goal for humanity, which is zero hunger. One of the features of the Paris Agreement, not only regarding agriculture, is the fact that it allows countries to put on the table their plans according to their realities. And that means not only economic realities, it means also social and political realities. In many cases, to make a change requires to change the laws, for instance, or to come up with new directives. There is a very broad common understanding that the world has to shift away from fossil fuels altogether and go into renewables. And there are some cases now that show that some renewables in some places in the world, because that's also a reality, it's not valid for everywhere. In some places in the world are really highly competitive with some fossil sources of energy. Having said that, I think that, and I have made this point many times, I think that we need to make a very serious and objective and sound conversation on the role of fossil fuels in the transition towards a carbon neutral world. In my mind, it is clear that in many cases, gas has been and will be one of the sources of energy in this transition.